session, and the first session today actually. We'd like to welcome our panelists for the program this afternoon. I'll start with Ashraf Patel. Ashraf, to give her a warm welcome. And she's a co-founder of Pravah. Ashraf, please come and join me. Mujib Khan, founder president of Bhumi. Anshu Gupta, founder and director of Bhumi. And Vishal Tarveja, director, founder, Dream and also Leisure Fellow. What I'm going to do is give them about 15 minutes. Some have promised that I'll finish in 5. I will give them 15 minutes each, and there before that, about 2 minutes before, I'll give you a warning thing, and you've done. So that you have 30 minutes at the end to question them. And the reason I kept it at the end is because maybe there'll be more than one of the speakers who want to answer the same question in a different manner. I'll also give you the basic introduction of as the speakers come along. So since Ashraf, I will not say ladies first or anything, but I, with great due respect, Ashraf, you're first, Ashraf Patel. Ashraf is a co-founder of Pravah and the current director of Pravah Learning Voyages, which offers a real-world learning opportunity to youth facilitators and organizations. She uses a vehicle with performing arts and various other times to discover yourself. And through yourself, you also manage to manage the environment. So Ashraf is a postgraduate from, guess where, XLRI, and an Ashoka fellow, and a trustee of the National Youth Foundation. She is also a working group member appointed by the Youth Ministry to make recommendations on the 11th plan. So may I ask Ashraf to come and make your presentation.
Presentation. I'm much more comfortable sharing some of the things that we are using in Pravah now. So I want to introduce you all to some of the work, research work we have done. So my talk right now is not looking at this as looking at any of you all, how I'm perceiving the audience right now, is looking at you all as designers and developers of youth interventions. Not necessarily as young people yourself, but really looking at as fact that everybody here is interested in you, in social entrepreneurship and in development. And looking at it from that perspective, what is it that we need to go out with and do to inspire and get more young people engaged in social action? So that's going to be the real tone of the presentation, with the idea that if all of us here can step out and introduce youth-friendly concepts in our work, then we will be promoting youth interventions. So it's really about creating an enabling. I want to start with a small exercise. Just put your hands up like this, please. Yeah? Okay. And fold your arms. Just any which way, how you fold your arms like this, just fold. So, just have a look. Some of you have done it before. Just have a look and see which hand, how your hands are placed. Just observe yourself very carefully. Which hand is going above which? Just don't change the position, just observe yourself and see what's going up and what's below. What else? It will be different for different people, right? You observe? Okay. Remember it. Put your hands out again and fold your arms differently. Put the right foot above the left and you move it. Yeah? Okay. How is it for you? Just generally some voices? Different?
Uncomfortable.
Confusing? Uncomfortable?
Yeah. The second one,
more conscious. Okay. So, just a small thing about what Pravah is all about. The whole idea for Pravah is the organization that I come from. The whole idea of the work we do is about getting young people to go beyond their comfort zones. And why young people? Actually, all of us, old people as well. The whole idea is to really get out of your comfort zones, explore yourself and the world around you, And this is, therefore, what I said is perspective on youth development, taking ownership of common spaces. This is how we see youth development spaces. And we really can't talk about social enterprise and development without really talking about the context that we are in. And this is very, we all know this, so I'm going to really rush this. But this is the general discourse today, right? Every paper that you read, every magazine that you read is really talking about nothing but this growth story, this fantastic country, and how we are going to beat China, and how we are the, you know, one of the fastest growing economies. So this is our major discourse today. But are things as rosy as they look? And of course, everybody here in this room is a social activist of some form or the other. So we know that that's not the whole picture. So on practically every development indicator, we have a lot of ground to cover. When we are talking about youth development and social entrepreneurship, it's really both sides of these stories we have to really keep in mind. Otherwise, one story can take over the other. And part of both these stories is, okay, so where are youth placed in all of this? And that's something that I'd like to spend about 5 minutes exploring. We feel that this dichotomy between the two sort of Indias, there are many reasons for it. There are many, many reasons for it. It's not a simplistic, there's no simplistic answer to the reason for the dichotomy on this high growth space and this poor development indicator situation. But one of the reasons why we feel this divergence is occurred is because of the way young people have been perceived and engaged over the last many years in social change processes. And I just want to introduce you to a study that we did with Oxfam. It was a study to inform the strategy table on their youth policy. And we came across this idea, okay, let's study what young people were doing at the time of the freedom movement, that's in the 40s, and how they were engaged, and try to connect it to the experiences of today. So we are not going to go into the details of the study, but it was interesting. And many of you will be familiar with this, but I wanted to share some of the things that we found out. The study, the primary research was done by meeting people who are in their 80s today. So they were young people when, you know, during the time of independence, they were part of the freedom movement. And the secondary study was done by studying the archives. You know, what did newspapers say about young people that time? What were the youth spaces that people were hanging out in? This was done by in collaboration with Teen Murti Memorial, where we actually studied the old newspapers and tried to get data of what is the common narrative in with relation to young people. We won't, again, I'm not taking you deep into the study, but this very quickly. Our study shows, and I want to share, the study was fairly urban. It was placed in a very urban context. The study shows that there was a thriving scene of the youth in the 40s. Young people were involved in any which way in the independence movement. Independence movement is considered to be the movement which was launched by young people. Okay, I'm broadly speaking, young people, anything between 25 to 40 is broadly how we define them. And young people were involved in different ways. It could be by participating in satyagraha, or by actually just taking a decision to wear khadi, or also in some ways participating in the revolutionary movements that we know of. We saw that participation in the freedom movement also connected us to their participation in parliament. So we saw that 26% in the first Lok Sabha and 32% in the second Lok Sabha. That was the percentage of young people in the first and the second Lok Sabha. So you see that young people's social engagement did get to a great extent translated into representation in parliament. However, we also see that, you all know this, again this is coming in the news also very lately, which is that somewhere this picture has changed dramatically. In 2009, our representation of youth was 6.3%, and this is old data actually. I haven't calculated the data now with the change, with the reshuffle that has happened vis-a-vis the cabinet at least, but definitely 6.3% in the Lok Sabha. It's come down heavily. This graph can show to you the blue graph, for example, shows the dropping population of youth in the Lok Sabha. And the higher age, the age going up. The other insight that I want to draw to your attention is, although there is representation of young people in the Lok Sabha was higher, finally when the cabinet is formed, the representation of young people is marginal. So what, that's one. The second is that over the years, the age of average age of the cabinet has only gone up. So this is it. This is all the data that I want to place this for you. And I just, obviously somewhere the picture is getting skewed. What we are concluding from here is that somewhere young people are mobilized, young people are activated, energized. But when it comes to participation in decision making, we are not being successful in creating the right kind of spaces, net. So it's all right for 100 people, young people to join your rally, but are they sitting together to decide how this will be done, what will happen? Are they in decision making? I think that's a question I would like to place in this larger discourse of youth development and social entrepreneurship. So somewhere we feel the contribution of young people may have got diminished into looking at young people as people who have to contribute their bit. What we say when we say volunteering, even on social enterprise, when we talk about social enterprise, we often hear this thing of, okay, you must do your bit for society. That is the narrative we would like to try to change. Let's change the language we use when we talk about young people and social change and volunteering and social and the narrative that we would like to change to something that is more youth-centered. We forget that the entire ocean is there with the young person. It's not about the ocean, the drop in the ocean, it's about the ocean in the drop. If we change the way we look at our programming in anything that we do, we may be able to increase youth participation. And very quickly now, some of the narratives I just want to introduce you all, and you'll be familiar with them. They just ring true because this is there in the newspapers. Today's narrative, the economics declares. You will hear in this conference tomorrow day after the conversations around youth as a workforce, youth as consumers. This is a very, very big narrative now, where we are only analyzing the demographic dividend from this perspective.
I'll have to check now.
Okay, we have to upskill people, we have to develop them as a workforce, we have to develop them as consumers. Both are real pictures, there is no denying. It's the truth, but it's not the whole truth. Then there's the problem solver lens, which is the lens of that young people, it's a deficit sort of mindset. That if there are more young people, then we will have to look at programs that will, for example, keep them off the street, keep them out of violence, keep them out of situations where, you know, we have to have more drug and alcohol abuse programs. So there is a mindset that therefore then looks at things with that lens, and therefore that kind of programming is initiated. Again, important, cannot be ignored, but again, it's not the whole truth. Third lens, the youth for development lens. This is a lens that many of us, all of us, NGOs, sometimes political parties, sometimes religious organizations, where we look at our perspective towards young people as cadres of social change. They are our cadres. So they are mobilized for particular causes, not for generic development, for specific, for feminism, for gender, for environment. So, it's again with the concept of youth for this. I think what we are now just trying to again, and I'm just coming back, is for all of you to question, what is the lens you wear? Even as young people, you know, as young people ourselves, what is the lens we wear when we look at ourselves and how therefore we see youth? What we are trying to talk about is, okay, when you're talking about youth and anything, to begin with, put on your youth development. And what is this youth development fest? Let us just examine. So how do we develop youth programs with a youth for youth safe strategy? What we are saying is every strategy is important. All the lessons are important. But don't miss out on the youth development lens. And for this, it's important to study what are the legitimate places that young people occupy today. We have the first legitimate place, family. And I don't know, this is just a risky question to ask, but I'll ask. Those who are not married here and consider themselves young people, how many of you would like your parents to choose your spouse? Just raise it, don't worry, we are not okay there, talk about it tomorrow again. Okay, so I can't say how much percentage of young people here is that, but there are enough. There is a study done by the Center for CSBS, where they found that 60% of young people in India, and this is a cross-cutting study, urban, rural, everything, 60% of young people today would prefer if their spouse was selected for parents. Okay? It was a surprise for me. I didn't think so, but that is true. And it shouldn't be a surprise. Our whole culture and the way we are. So family is really, it's an indicator of the how important the family space is. Just the other day, Hindustan Times has come out with a poll. And that's very urban though. There also again it's come out that family is a very, very crucial and the most legitimate space where young people hang out, which means that young people give family a lot of legitimacy and the family and the vice versa. Of course, this is obvious, this is a no-brainer. Career and career-related studies, again, anything you want to do for your career, you will be encouraged to try out because it's going to help in the future. Friends, again, legitimate space for young people to hang out. And leisure and lifestyle. Always understood that there will be a lot of recreation wherever there is young people. There is this other space, which is fifth space, which we've gone like far away. Like you see, it is a space we call, we are not giving it a name, but we call it the fifth space. And this is a space where we say it is the space for young people to engage in volunteering and social action. This is not a legitimate space today. And it may be legitimate for all of us in this room because we are in this business. But it's not a legitimate space. Still, today you have difficulty, young people have difficulty in engaging in social change and social action processes. It's considered something you do out there. It's considered as something you do for other people. It's not legitimized, but it exists. What we acknowledge is that it exists, but it's very tiny. And what we are trying to say that at the time of independence, this space was fully legitimized. If you were participating in the freedom movement, you were legitimized, your parents would actually say, please go, my child is doing this wonderful thing. So if there was legitimacy created, because of course there was social context, there is no running away from that. But today the space to participate in social processes is little bit marginalized, heavily marginalized. What we'd like to do as Pravah and as a collective of organizations who work on this would like to do is mainstream the fifth space. And this is really where now our efforts are. There can be influence policy to mainstream the fifth space. How do we do that? This is really an appeal to everybody here. We have to create processes so that parents encourage young people to go out there and experience social change processes. And not only just to go out there and do social work, but also to experience self-transformation. When we say fifth space, we don't mean it is just going out there and doing something for yourself. It is doing something for yourself. It's connecting the self to the social. And I think that definition itself, if we focus on a lot more, that what is social change, it's as much about self-transformation as about social transformation. It's not one or the other. Because it's being one or the other, we feel the fissures and the divides have happened in our context. Either you look at self-transformation in this very, very quote-unquote, I don't mean it in any negative way, but I think it's in a very self-absorbed seen as something that's supposed to be done alone, self-absorbed, in a particular, maybe religious context, whatever. That's the only definition. And social work is seen as something that you do out there with, for some other people. But no, it's together. The self and the social somehow have to come together, and that is really what we are saying, that more and more we need organizations to look at that. So let's come back to this. So we are trying to say, okay, can we all together, all of us here, work towards maximizing this self space? And we can do that if there is freely encourage children and youth to go and experience contexts which are different from their own. Career and career related. How wonderful it would be if the corporates which would even come for placement here at XLRI would actually look at the fact that the person who's been engaged in social enterprise of any kind, that they look up to that, they give value to that, there is an added understanding that this person has something much more than someone else who doesn't have that experience. But that's not true, that doesn't happen. Why? Because we've not really built enough noise around it, we've not really communicated to the world what difference it makes for an individual when they engage in social change processes, and what difference it makes for the person. So they are getting a better person in their organization. So could we work on accreditation and creating opportunities so that SIP space can also mainstream? It becomes important to strengthen the career. Their friends is okay. Most of you, I'm sure, have had this experience when you go volunteering and everybody says, two time-based talent, pure entertainment. The fourth is, of course, leisure and lifestyle. Many of these spaces are seen as boring. Much of this work is seen as serious. Of course it's serious, but it can also be fun. So how do we make what we do in this space enjoyable? Very quickly coming to the Pravah program, I want to share some of our experiments with the fifth space. This is an hourglass. This is a concept which sort of defines the idea of space and time, which we feel is important for young people's experience in social action. You need to give it time and space for it to be transformational. It cannot be just a project or an experiment. It's got to be a lifelong process which you initiate. So I'm going to just rush through this because we have a presentation on the Change Change program. It's a program for social entrepreneurs. We especially have, which my colleague Amit is going to make a presentation on tomorrow. So I'm not going to go into these details, but I'll just share some photographs and some processes. This is a program called SMILE, and it has many layers. In the first year, we expect young people to be engaged in volunteering activities. It's pretty much like any school or college project where they go and work with NGOs and spend a few days, a few weeks, whatever their time is suitable to them. This is the volunteering program where they are catches. They help, they support, they serve. Second role we sort of create a platform for students to play is alchemist, where you create something. So you have a certain talent. All of us have talent. Human beings have potential of number of times. So the whole idea is to help them to identify what is their core talent and use that talent to create something. So if you're a musician or if you're a theatre person or if you're interested in researching, then you would take up an issue with a bunch of people. The whole idea is to work with a bunch of people and work on that together. So this is the alchemist role we encourage them to play. The third layer is the activist. This everybody knows. You cannot be a social activist unless you can advocate for a cause, for your cause. So getting them to advocate with in their peer communities. Of course, a learner, which means the workshop on self and social transformation on social issues. This is the fifth year, which is internship. We offer, I think Ankit has mentioned it in the morning, the idea of young people going to Anandman, for example, he mentioned very passionately. And see what impact it has had on. I can just feel the impact that it had on him from his presentation in the morning. So This is really about having young people go and experience. There are these three photographs, so very quickly let me explain one of them, which is the exposure to Beat Bachao Andolan, which is an organization of Sathas. And here you learn about biodiversity and you see its connection to yourself by the experiences that are constructed over there. And then you learn about food security. And then some of them may become activists in the area of food security. So to see for yourself, to work on these issues yourself becomes critical. And most importantly, to meet people, to meet really exciting people and role models who you don't get a chance to otherwise. Finally, this is the last layer, which is social entrepreneurs, which are actually people who will set up interventions. And this is a program called Change Room, which will present again later. There are three change roomers sitting here. I hope I don't embarrass you, but I really want to celebrate your achievements. But there are, Shovik is here. Shovik, don't mind me, I'm going to surprise you like this. Shovik. And there are many social entrepreneurs here, but there are three who, we know and we've journeyed together, so I'm just proud to share some information. Shovik is working in Jharkhand. There's Dhirendra here, who set up an enterprise. And there's Anirban, who we'll be meeting today, I don't know where he is. But some of the people who have joined in this journey with us, Anirban is going to share more in detail in the afternoon, and have given an opportunity for Pravah to learn about social enterprise in a much, much more detailed way. So really, this is about setting up organization. I won't really end my presentation, that we can build social entrepreneurship amongst young people only if we introduce the idea of reflection. We have a lot of programs which involve young people, but we do not focus enough time on reflection. So we find this thing called reflection, which is to reflect and act. And some of the principles for a youth program that promotes social entrepreneurship is to train ownership, encourage trust, enhance entrepreneurship and connect us to sustainable market models. Because it's hard, this is really the hardest part, how to convert a social enterprise also into something that is viable. Provide opportunities for cross-border engagement. This is the other thing we really focus on, that if an experience does not inspire you to meet people from other communities, doesn't enable you to break your boundaries, then you're still living in a siloed world. And that is not social transformation, nor the most right. And making it fun, joyful, and transformative. This is in a nutshell what Pravah programs are all about. And I'm very happy to say, I'm very glad that Ankit and Yashvi came and presented. And this is really about social, promoting youth and youth social entrepreneurship. Lovely to have young people here on the dais to share their experiences. That's what we have to do. Thank you.